Psychologists of Reddit, have you ever been genuinely scared by a patient before? What's your story? I suffered from psychosis due to bipolar disorder, and when I was in the thick of it, it made me manipulative, self-centered, and I heard people outside my house talking about me and saw ghosts in my room. I treated my partner like crap and would hit him with heavy backpacks or my purse. But people stuck by me, God knows how hard it must have been for them, because, much like your friend, I am otherwise known by people who care about me as highly empathetic, open, calm, and honest, but psychosis can turn you into someone you don't even recognize, and it's like you watch yourself do these drastic things wishing you could stop it, but you're just a passenger in your own head. Your friend's situation seems clinically worse than mine was, but I can definitely empathize, and I'm happy she has someone like you in your life who understands who she really is. I'm sure you do, because you sound like a good friend, but make sure to remind her when she's at her worst that you know who she really is and don't blame her. Saw a new client for our first session at my home practice. We seemed to click and work together fine. He said he wanted to work through some trauma he'd experienced when he was physically attacked by a previous psychologist. Hearing about terrible psychologists always riles me up, so I was immediately on his side. When I talked with my supervisor about the case a week later, she asked me his full name, which never happened, so I was weirded out immediately. She googled the name then and there and wordlessly handed me her iPad. It was full of news articles about this client and his attacks on psychologists in my local area. I obviously did not see him again, but I was nervous for ages because he knew where I lived. I'm a therapist, but not a psychologist, if that matters. I used to work in a facility for kids and adolescents with pretty intense behavioral issues. Even when a client was aggressive, I was usually able to de-escalate them, and I generally didn't feel unsafe. In fact, most of the time I was concerned about their safety during outbursts. With one exception, I had a client that was pretty strong and prone to intense tantruming. This client was acting in a way that was unsafe, had a plan to seriously hurt another resident, I think. So I had to put them on restriction, within staff eyesight at all times. Their response was to run up to me and attempt to choke me. Luckily, the staff got there in time and prevented this kid from seriously hurting me. On another occasion, this same client also took apart their curtain rod in their bedroom and swung it at my head. I dodged in time. Oddly enough, this client and I had a pretty good relationship the other 99% of the time, and I generally enjoyed working with them. Not me, but a friend, who is the patient, has what's described as treatment-resistant psychosis. She's not a scary person at all, in fact she's really sweet and caring. But she hears voices that tell her that her parents and little brother will be raped and tortured if she doesn't follow what they say. Sometimes the voices convince her that staff members at the psychiatric intensive care unit she's on are working for the government and trying to run experiments on her and put bugs under her skin. So her voices will tell her to attack staff members. Not super often, but it happens. Whenever it does, she feels terrible afterwards and will cry for hours on end and beg for forgiveness. One of her voices also makes her do her ritual, in which she strips down completely naked, and sometimes eats her own shit. She herself is not a scary person. Psychosis itself is such a scary and heartbreaking illness. Because she's not a violent person and has tons of compassion and empathy for others. Psychotic does not equal psycho or sociopath. Clinical psychologist here. I used to work in a prison and did a parole evaluation for an inmate that was a high-ranking gang member in a national gang. By his account, he was the highest ranking in the state. In fact, he was placed in that prison to hold his people accountable and keep the peace. He had a long violent record and was, in my opinion, a genuine psychopath. Part of the eval is discussing the crime and assessing remorse and whatnot. He was so clinical in his description of how he tortured and left this guy to die over an unpaid debt. Live by the sword, die by the sword was his phraseology for act. Like it was nothing. He was also very nonchalant about his ability to take care of his business while inside. I believed him. He had only spent 18 months of his last 15 years outside of prison. My recommendation was not to parole him. There were various factors that I gave, and in the end the parole board went with my recommendation. So the part that actually scared me, this was my first parole eval, was this guy's ability to affect the world outside. He could have sent someone to my house if he wanted to. I had no doubt about that. More experienced psychologists told me not to worry about it. That he knew the score and wouldn't take it personally. I had a hard time buying it. I was running a long-term offender group a few months later and he was part of it. After the first group, I pulled him aside and asked if we were good. He smiled at me and told me not to worry. I did my job and he didn't blame me for writing what I did because it was true. He went on to be a really insightful and active group member. A very sweet, mostly blind teenager who was going through his first psychotic break and had a love of martial arts, Taekwondo, if I remember correctly, was really, really, really good at it. He couldn't see and would practice kicks, and at one point, accidentally kicked one of the reinforced shatterproof windows in the quiet room, think padded room without the padding. Turns out they were shatter resistant, he destroyed it with that kick. Why those particular details? Because he would practice his kicks everywhere, was mostly blind, and the one time he flipped up to practice one and I was walking around the corner, it came literal centimeters from my face, and I felt the impact of it against the air, like a physical force bashing into my face. Sweetest kid in the world, he would have been horrified if it had connected, because things would have broken. A lot of things. He also grabbed my arm once in a suddenly firm grasp and asked if I wanted to do Taekwondo with him. No. No, I did not. Clinical psychologist in training here. I've never been afraid, but my friend had a client once who made her extremely uncomfortable. Without revealing any information that could break confidentiality, I will say that he had issues with masturbating too much, and not doing much else, and at one point asked my friend if they could watch porn together in the next session so he could show her what he does. At another time, he talked about his masturbation habits while touching his dick through his pants a bit, totally inappropriate behavior, obviously. This client had lots of other issues, but when these things came up, her supervisor took her off the case because it wasn't suitable for training and my friend didn't feel safe. Once when I was a medical student, I was asked to see a patient in the psychiatric unit of the emergency room. I walked in with my short white coat and clipboard and asked the guy what brought him in today and what was wrong. He looked me dead in the eyes with foamy saliva dribbling from the corner of his mouth and a strange smell in the air and said, "The devil told me to kill you and kill myself." He was sweaty and his eyes were bloodshot and his wife beater had dark red/brown stains on it. The door was behind him and I wasn't sure I could make it there before something bad happened. No idea if he had a weapon on him. Was afraid of calling loudly for help. I was in a quiet corner of the ER and I felt like I would have had to yell to get attention and I didn't want to startle him. I stayed there for a half hour and asked him more questions. Slipped out when he started to look sleepy. I have an aunt who experienced a psychotic break a couple years ago, and my mom's siblings have tried to keep the details hush-hush between themselves and aunt's immediate family, but my mom spilled the beans to us recently. Turns out she refuses to medicate for schizophrenia because she believes the voices in her head are prophetic, and she has a lot of rage directed towards my brother for a completely imaginary reason. She has invented some scenario in which he is the reason why her family was struggling financially at the time she experienced her break. She used to host big family gatherings that I loved growing up, but now we rarely see them anymore because my immediate family is on the outs as far as she's concerned. I had no idea until a couple months ago that that was why we hadn't seen them in so long except for at my dad's funeral last year, because us kids, we're all adults now, have been mostly sheltered from the truth. It breaks my heart that my relationship with my favorite aunt is pretty much non-existent now, and it doesn't seem likely that I'll be seeing much of her in the future. Not a psychologist, but saw a breakdown in my ex that scared me senseless. He had just started meds and the meds reacted horribly with him for whatever reason. He mostly had hallucinations, but sometimes he'd black out and do activities and not remember them. He would call me screaming at 3 a.m. and he didn't remember a second of it. Any of it. He had hallucinations before, but they got increasingly dangerous with these meds. In particular, I think of one instance. While on the phone during an episode, he said, "I boiled some water." I asked why, as it was 3 a.m., and he replied eerily calmly, "They told me I have to stick my hand in here." It was absolutely terrifying. I finally begged him to go to the hospital that following morning to ask for a medication change and he begrudgingly obliged. While he was there, he started throwing up blood and had to get his stomach pumped. Turns out, in one of his blackouts, he swallowed his entire bottle of medication. I'm a farm worker, the grandson of the guy I worked for was off the charts crazy, the grandparents couldn't control him, they bought him a .22 rifle, it had a trigger lock, they gave him the key and some ammunition, I locked it away because he was 6 years old. He threatened to shoot me so I put him in timeout, he crapped on the floor and laughed like a crazy asshole. I came to find out it was his sister's rifle I took away, because a few hours later he came outside with his rifle trigger lock off bolt in and ammunition in his pocket to kill me for taking away his sister's gun. Every day I had to deal with something like this. I have seen other workers chasing this 6-year-old kid with hammers. He was bat crap crazy. I have many stories about that year. I warned him to stop playing on the roof of a tractor, he would get hurt, and I am not there to watch that bullshit. He starts to get down and just seemed to flop down on purpose, landed stomach first on the back of the tractor. It would have hurt so bad. He cried for about 20 seconds, then cackled with laughter. He probably broke ribs, and I saw massive bruises on his stomach when he lifted his shirt to check for cuts. I watched him kill baby chickens by first saying how cute and petting them, then standing on them. He tortured the farm dog to the point it growled when he went near, and one point I actually had to stop the dog from killing him. It had him by the back of the neck and was chomping down. He was crying then burst into laughter. I can't speak enough about this kid to convey the frustration he would cause. He scared me, and I was on a farm where aggressive black Angus bulls were a daily thing. Everyone hated that kid, and I am relieved I'm not around him anymore. Hess, coming your way, psychologists. When I was studying psychology my final year, I had the opportunity to meet with convicted felons. Essentially, I sat down and spoke to a man, in his 30s-ish, who is a actual offender. He told me he used to marry women and then rape their young daughters, each was in the range of 6 to 7 years old. I listened to him explain it. It was literally my instructions not to judge them. I had to sign a waiver to not get emotional. So I asked him about the home life of those he abused. Head say that some of the women he married had other children, and in one case there was an older sister who was 13, but he would never ever touch her. Head drop her off at school, where he told me he was never into any of the children he saw, and take her to practice and friend's house, and while she was gone, head go back and rape her 6-year-old sister. He told me that it really isn't always about being attracted to prepubescent girls, it's about the dominance and power that come with having wax with them. Hess being rehabilitated now though. Weird part was that I wasn't sure if he was acting remorseful, BC if he was, he is amazing at it. He was just very open to my questions and expressed regret, and I almost believed him. However, when I met a man who was convicted of child porn, his I feel terribles were transparent and so full of crap it was disgusting. My professors warned me about manipulation, so that was easy to catch on to, but with the previous guy? He was either an impeccable liar and manipulator, or he genuinely wanted to get better, and I honestly still don't know what the flying duck to believe. Edit, grammar mistake / clarity. I'm not a psychologist, but I have 2 psych degrees and have been in and out of psychiatric wards since my late teens. For 14 years I worked with adults with developmental disabilities. So, as you can imagine, I've seen my fair share of frightening behavior. But nothing scared me more than nannying for a 5-year-old boy with autism and a mood disorder. He had just been released from the hospital where he had stayed for a month to get acclimated to behavioral meds. But in the short 2 weeks I nannied for him, I feared for my life. He would kick, bite, scratch, hit, spit, come after me with knives, punch cars, scream loud enough for neighbors to think he was being abused, and destroyed his mother's picture-perfect apartment. And when I tried to tell his mom that he needed more help than a babysitter could give him, she fired me saying I was wrong and that he just needs someone more attentive. Complete denial. My brother-in-law is low-functioning autistic and blind. At one point his care provider, who had worked with him for years and knew him quite well, got into a very dangerous situation with him. She had worked with him since he was smaller and had become experienced at interacting safely when he would become angry and aggressive. They had found a good balance of medication for him and she let her guard down. This time though, he was now 20 years old and 6 foot tall. In a split second, he attacked her, jumping up from the couch directly across from her chair. He was very strong and viciously aggressive. I have found myself in tough situations with him, and I'm 6'4 inches 225 pounds. After receiving quite a few blows from his hands, hair torn out and bites on her arms and hands, she was able to push away across the ground and get behind the couch he had been sitting on. She quickly slid the couch into a corner so that he wouldn't have a way around it easily, and she hid herself behind it and tried to be very quiet. He searched that corner of the room for over an hour, following the front and side edges of the couch with his hands, back and forth pacing until he eventually lost interest and went to play with some toys off in the corner of the room. She got out of the corner and ran for her door just as her assistant was coming to remind her that she had gone over the allotted time. My Bill is an amazing guy and I've had some awesome experiences with him over the years, but the idea of being hunted by sound like that is pretty freaky. Good friend of mine's wife is a psychologist at a well-known prison and sees some seriously ducked up people for a living. Let's just say, Hannibal inspired her to do what she does for a living, and she's as close to Clarice as a person can probably get in real life. She is usually briefed on relevant details before she is assigned to a case. This includes court proceedings, testimonies, etc. She's heard recordings of murders and other such disturbing shit. She's tough as nails, and I guess she loves psychoanalyzing scary psychos. She had to be taken off a case because she was so uneasy, disturbed, and threatened by one of her clients. Apparently this guy was either a serial rapist or murderer. She couldn't give lots of details, but he has a victim profile and she fit it. He started to behave strangely towards her, trying to converse with her and get to know her. He would write her letters and draw her pictures, and attempt to give her tokens and things. All the things he would do to his victims, well, everything possible under the circumstances. She was so upset and disturbed by his special attention that she was even afraid at the grocery store and started to feel uneasy in her home at night. Despite the fact that this guy was locked up in a maximum security prison. She described it like a hunter-slash-prey vibe on a really weird animalistic level. She was taken off his case and received counseling. When she told me about it, she was very honest and matter-of-fact. This is a hazard of the job she works. While she may talk about her patients as if they are lab rats, this was one case you could tell really got under her skin and spooked her. Edit. Obviously giving tokens and letters is not only creepy but violates the doctor-patient relationship. She would decline very firmly and clearly, and I guess maybe some stuff was intercepted before he had the chance to try and actually give it to her? It's been about 10 years since I heard the story, but it stuck with me. Obligatory. Not a psychologist, but I used to work as an aide in a special education classroom in a middle school. The year I started, a majority of my workload was 8th grade boys, and two of them had deeply troubling behavioral issues. One kid assaulted a girl in his class. At school. In front is a bunch of other kids. He actually got arrested for it, but the school couldn't expel him because of his disability. For the rest of the year, he was forbidden from being anywhere, including the lunchroom, with her. I spent a lot of time essentially babysitting this kid. And because he didn't give a duck about school, he did practically nothing during his time in the resource room. The last I heard, he'd been arrested again for breaking into someone's house and stealing a handgun. But the one who scared me was completely antisocial, to the point of threatening to hurt himself or others when a field trip or school assembly was coming up. We eventually had to tell his parents in advance so they wouldn't bring him to school. He talked about death constantly, all while extremely medicated, so it was a very muted, mumbled, and done through a thousand-yard stare with spittle coming from his mouth. One of the teachers was pregnant. She wasn't his teacher, but he knew who she was, and one day he asked me would Mrs. X's baby live if someone ran her over in a car? I told him I didn't know and tried to change the subject. Then he asked what if someone cut her stomach open? What if they stabbed her? What if she had been dead for a while and no one found her? This really freaked me out, and I had to report it to the sped teacher. When I told her, she said he had asked her and other students the same thing and scared the crap out of them. She said the pregnant teacher had been advised to avoid him, in case he did or said anything to upset her.